All right, it's time for another Comics Are Great, the visual storytelling show recorded live every Wednesday afternoon at 12:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time at the Ann Arbor District Library, right on the corner of 5th and William in lovely Ann Arbor, Michigan. And my name is Jersey Drozd. I'm a cartoonist and teaching artist. And with me, I've got a whole bunch of really exciting people with me today. But we'll start with probably the one who has the most exciting news. Raina Telgemeier is with us. Hey, Raina.
Hey, Jersey.
And she's with her husband, Dave, who just jumped off a camera like a ninja.
No, it's okay.
So we're giving Raina, Raina's not going to be here for very long. We just want to give her a chance to say hi and to congratulate her on the exciting news. Yes, let's give a round of applause to Raina Telgemeier of GoRaina.com.
Where's your award?
What'd you get?
Yeah, Smile won the Eisner Award for Woo-hoo. Best Publication for Teens over the weekend at Comic-Con, and it was awesome.
Yeah.
And Dave said I should go get it so I can show it.
Yeah, you should. You should.
So
I mean,
let's hand it over to Dave for a second.
So, okay, then now, while she's gone, Dave, Dave Roman of yaytime.com, you can tell us, what's it really like at the Eisner Award ceremony? You know, is it pretty nerve-wracking?
It's great. Luckily, Raina was the second award of the evening, so we didn't have to wait too long, and her trembling didn't have to go through the entire ceremony, which tends to go about 3 hours.
Wow. Oh, there she is. Here comes. If you ever wondered what an Eisner looks like, well, you posted pictures online, Raina.
I did, but it's much cooler in person.
Yeah, look at that.
Because in the photos, you can't tell that the little globe actually spins.
No way. Oh, wow.
And so it says, Will Eisner Comic Industry Awards 2011 on the globe. And then it says, Best Publication for Teens, Smile, at the bottom. So, yay.
That is awesome.
It weighs like a pound and a half.
It's a weapons grade award. Now, there's a ton of things that are great about this. One is that you won in the category that counts right now, right? We want more young people to read comics. That's important to me. But also, more women winning the Eisner. Thank goodness. And you get to represent, right?
That's right.
So, Smile, everybody anybody who hasn't read this book should read this book. You can get it at GoRaina.com, right? Now it's
you
an
can,
award winner.
And I also recommend people check out their local independent bookstore or their local comic shop. And if they don't carry it there, ask them to order a copy. Maybe they'll order an extra copy, and then maybe somebody else will see it there and decide they'll give it a shot as well.
What advice do you give to people who are nominated for awards like this for preparation? What'd you do to prepare? Like, I saw pictures. I saw pictures of you up on that podium, and you looked pretty calm and collected.
Oh, are you kidding me? I move my face too much when I talk, so all of the photos of me are like, like I look like I'm contorting and having a demon exercise from my brain. I don't know. I was a nervous wreck. I was shaking. I wasn't able to eat a lot. Like, they had a dinner, and I was, like, picking at it. And they took the food away as soon as the award ceremony started. So, of course, I won the award. And then I was starving. Yeah. And there was no more food. So, I guess sneak a granola bar into the ceremony if you think you're going to need it later.
Oh, that's a good idea. Sneak in some food.
I'm just grateful that so many people voted for me. I mean, I really had no idea there were a lot of other amazing books nominated in the category, and I'm a big fan of some of those people, so to be in competition with them, I hated it.
Don't say you wouldn't have clawed off their faces.
Don't vote for my other friend.
Oh, no.
Vote for me. So I'm glad it's over, honestly, and that we can all go back to being friends and colleagues again and not competitors.
Yeah. Oh, well, there's plenty of awards to go around, right? You
true.
Know, and it's not a competition. So
yeah, sure.
No, it's not. I mean, a nomination counts, right? A nomination means that you still did a good thing, right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, I don't want to turn into one of those "we're all winners" kind of things, but at the same time, you know, it's like people put an undue stress on this, but at the same time, you deserve congratulations. So, what advice would you give to Dave for next year when he's nominated for the Eisner for Astronaut Academy?
Bring a granola bar.
That's it. Deep breaths.
No. I feel like it's exciting that we can sort of be nominated and take advantage of social networking and sort of get the word out on Twitter and Google+ and Facebook and everywhere else. So I don't know. Get your friends to vote for you.
Get your friends to vote for. That's pretty good advice. Okay. one more thing that we should make a note of while you're here is you also announced your new project, which, Raina, when I read the title, I was like, that is so genius. Why didn't I think of that? That's a great title and a great topic for a book aimed at that group of kids. What's it called?
It's called Drama.
Yeah.
And it's a book about stage crew kids and their sort of rivalries and romances with the kids who are in the cast of the musical that their school is putting on. So it's just the process of making a play happen and all the drama that goes along with it.
Oh, that's brilliant. It's going to be a bestseller. There's no question in my mind. I've already, just based on Smile, but also based on that concept alone and with you behind the wheel. Oh, that's going to be a hit for sure.
Fall of 2012, Scholastic Graphics, and I'm halfway through the art right now, so I got to go and go back to
work. Getting back to work. Well, thanks for stopping by, Raina Telgemeier of GoRaina.com. Congratulations Yay. Again on the Eisner. Good for you.
Thanks, guys.
So long, Raina.
I'll turn it back over to Dave now.
We get Dave back in the shot. Thank you. Okay, so now we have Dave Roman here of YayTime.com, Astronaut Academy. And then I should also introduce, I didn't get a chance to introduce before, the other guest here today, our in-studio guest, Kevin Coppa of, I got to look up the URL to your YouTube channel. YouTube.com/cornersphere, spelled with a K, K-O-R-N-E-R, sphere. Yeah.
I wish I'd picked a better name now because nobody gets that right.
Oh, really?
Not even me.
Well, you know, all the names are taken nowadays that are easy to spell.
It is. Cornersphere with a C is taken, you know, all these other different names. So.
Yeah. So there's no such thing as is easy to spell Earl anymore. But, okay, so real quick, I want to talk about this with Dave. Look what I got in the mail.
Awesome. That's great.
Yeah. So we should talk about this. And shame on you, Dave, for not bringing this up 2 weeks ago when we were on the show together.
You know, I actually thought to, and then we got distracted.
I did too. So shame on me. I had it in my notes for follow-up. But what is this thing? What is this thing that you're in?
Well, I am also semi behind it. Carmen Moraes and Chris Duffy and I are former editors at Nickelodeon Magazine, and we decided to get the band back together, calling on all our former editors and designers at Nickelodeon Magazine to create a comic specifically for the kids of Joplin, Missouri, who lost their homes. Oh,
wow. Have you seen this yet?
No, I haven't.
From the tornado, I guess it was like almost 2 months ago, a little longer. And we had been hearing about all these kids that were displaced from their homes and that they were, you know, in camps and, you know, libraries and stuff. So we did not a Kickstarter, but an Indiegogo fundraiser to basically produce over 2,000 copies of these comics that were already actually sent out to the kids of Joplin to sort of, you know, just help cheer them up, give them something special. You know, comics can be a lot of fun, and there's also a lot of interactive comics to it. It's a great little anthology of kids' comics, but it's also like make your own comics and fill in the blank comics and puzzle comics and stuff like that, which I think will give it a little bit extra value or, you know, more time that they can, you know, enjoy it.
So what's the address for this project, the Comics Express project? It's just Comics Express on the Twitters, right? If I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, Comics Express on Twitter. If you just look up Comics Express and maybe Joplin MO, you should be able to find it. I forget the exact.
We'll put a link in the show notes. But,
yeah, that'd be great.
But worthy project. Hats off to you guys for putting this thing together. You know, I kicked in, actually, Anne kicked in on both of our behalfs. And
we
she said,
that, thank you.
And she turned to me, she's like, I donated to some today. I was like, what? And she's like, well, I don't think you'll mind. And I looked at what it was. I was like, oh, no, that's a very worthy project. So, no, really, hats off. You deserve a pat on the back for that, for putting that together, guys. That's terrific.
It really actually Carmen really did the most work on it, and she was just really passionate about it, and I think that Chris and I were happy to be a part of it, but it was Carmen who really kept the thing moving and made sure that it happened really fast. Like, that's what I was most impressed by, is that she really got everything together really quickly and then got some of the former designers at McMagazine to, you know, really pull it all together. So it was really exciting.
Pretty cool. Okay, well, now let's talk about Avatar, shall we? because we got Kevin Coppa here of the Avatar, the Last Puppetbender. And are you going to change the name of this series now because of the new series?
I thought about it a little bit. I thought, yeah. I mean, but how do you really change that? Is it the Last Korra Bender? I mean, you know, the Legend of Korra Bender or the Legend of Puppetbender?
Yeah.
I'm just going to stick with probably the Legend, you know, Last Puppetbender, the Legend of Korra is probably what I'll stick with. It's funny thing is, though, if I noticed that the Nickelodeon unveiling, both at their booth and both at the panel that they held at Comic-Con this year, they dropped Avatar from the title entirely.
It's just called Legend of Korra.
Because of James Cameron's movie and everybody getting... Every time I bring up Avatar with somebody's like, oh, the Blue Kitty movie? I'm like, no, the bending thing? Oh, the Shyamalan film? Are you crazy? And I'm like, no, you don't understand the show's better.
So now it's,
I believe it's The Last Airbender, The Legend of Korra, which kind of makes no sense because...
She's an Avatar.
She's an Avatar. She doesn't know airbending yet, but it's kind of like The Last Airbender. There's, as was revealed at the panel, there's more airbenders now, so...
Yeah, but it seems like The Last Airbender seems to be like the brandable.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Like that's their brand now rather than Avatar, which I feel like they lost that. They lost that battle.
Yeah, rug got pulled out from under them.
So are you guys basically doing damage control now with Avatar advocacy because of the not only the James Cameron film, but because of the Shyamalan film?
Actually, it's funny. I don't think there's a single fan. Well, maybe there are a few, and I don't mean to insult anybody who did like the movie. But most people I talk to, the fan base, I mean, we don't have to. You know, everybody knows it was not that much of a... What's the nicest way to put this, Dave? A not-so-enjoyed movie.
I have not seen it yet, but I've been advised against it. So.
You know, I think you should. I think everybody should see it at least once just so they know. It's not the worst movie ever made.
Yeah.
In my opinion, it's the worst thing ever made.
Wow.
So, wow. I mean, it's like there's no excuse for some of the things that went on in that film.
Worse than Transformer 2 or Transformers 2.
Oh, yeah.
Whoa. Wow.
I'm a big Mystery Science Theater 3000 fan.
Yeah.
And some of those films have more love in the craft of them than this thing did.
Wow. That is a strong statement. Wow. Now I have to see it out of morbid curiosity.
that's the only way to view it. If you do, get the riff tracks. You know, the guys from Mystery Science Theater, they did the downloadable riff tracks. Play with that. It's a great fun.
Okay. Well, then I will.
No comment over here.
I know.
The Teddy Ruxpin of comics abstains from the discussion. So I want to talk about for those who haven't met you yet, the puppet bending series that you do, the series of videos on YouTube, the Avatar The Last Puppet Bender. So, we can announce right here, we can show off, indeed. You have the new Korra.
I made for the Comic-Con, to kind of show her off a little bit here, is the new puppet Korra that we made.
Wow.
And...
turn her around for the camera.
Oh, okay. We got this camera. Then we got that camera up there. Actually... A puppet is always just dead until you actually put your hand inside of it. So let me see if I can get my hand in here.
So this isn't quite an exclusive to Comics Are Great, but it's kind of an exclusive. It's an internet exclusive. We're breaking the news here that there is a Korra puppet bender at long last. And I know the world is dying to know what she sounds like.
Well, right now she sounds like this. Unfortunately. She's got a... Man Korra voice.
Well, we were talking before the show started that Korra does look pretty tough.
Oh, yeah. I will break you with my shoulders. My shoulders of pain.
So awesome. So, yes, this is a series of – this is a show you've been doing. How long have you been doing this?
Gosh, well, it started in 2008, actually, and it was kind of a bit of a sort of a contest entry in a way. David was going to be hosting a fan panel at the New York Comic Con in 2008. And he put out a call for fan videos that they wanted to have a compilation of that people could submit. And he listed kind of a list of ideas to kind of get the juices flowing for people to make videos. And one of those things is, make puppets or something. You know, puppet video. Kind of like, I'm sure he was thinking of Harry Potter Puppet Pals.
Puppet Pals, yeah.
Exactly. Which is just a fantastic series and I love it a lot. Mm. And so I thought, well, that's cool. I bet I could do that. That'd be pretty good. I think we had like three or four weeks to do it in. And I was like, this would be so cool. I have all these great ideas. I'm going to make all five characters, and we're going to do this story. And I wrote the story down. And it'd be great if we could film it because, you know, I work in film video production here in Michigan, actually. And I had all this equipment, so I was able to do it. Well, little did I know, I've never made super professional puppets before. I mean, I've made lots of other arts and crafty things like that, but I never made anything quite of this caliber. And those 3 weeks were pretty much spent entirely figuring out how to make the puppets.
Oh, wow.
I only wound up making the guys. I made Aang, Zuko, and Sokka. And then we filmed it, and then I wound up editing it in the hotel room in New York, like hours before we showed it. And so that's how it got started.
He handed me like a disc that we put on the computer like 10 minutes before the panel.
Oh my gosh. Wow. So, okay. You did a workshop on this actually at the Ann Arbor District Library back in June, and where you showed how you use Final Cut Pro, by the way. Sorry to hear about Final Cut Pro.
Oh my gosh.
As bad as Avatar, the Last Airbender movie?
You think I'm going to get in trouble for being mean about the Shyamalan movie?
Yeah.
Just don't even get me started on Final Cut Pro. Okay.
You mean iMovie 10?
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
No, that says it all. So, I mean.
Yeah. And that kind of broke my heart, because after I saw your presentation at the Ann Arbor District Library, I was like, I got to get Final Cut. And then like a week or two later, they released Final Cut Pro.
Well, you won't be able to do quite what I was doing before.
Yeah. But anyway, so yeah, you shoot these shows with your own cameras, and then you edit it all in Final Cut Pro. You upload it to YouTube. I encourage everybody who is a remote, even the slightest fan of Avatar The Last Airbender, if you haven't seen these videos, it's at youtube.com/cornersphere, KORNERSPHERE. Stop listening to the show right now. Go watch them, for crying out loud. They're hysterical.
You can also just go on YouTube and type Avatar Puppets, and it's usually the first thing that pops up in your search.
Avatar Puppetbenders, that works too. Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure. So, but again, link will be in the show notes for after the fact.
Just a word of warning in a way. It's like the humor that we have in the videos is really geared toward people who know the show.
That's true.
A lot of people are like, oh, I'd love to see your videos, but I really didn't get it. I'm like, well, I know if you haven't seen Avatar, I mean, the jokes are very much geared towards the fandom and sort of in jokes that they've shared through the years. And
Great segue that I want to talk to you guys about this. Because just for a moment with, just to kind of back out and do some philosophical talking about this, because this is something that came up on a past Comics Are Great when I was talking with Paul Story. Mm-hmm. Fan contributions to something. Dave, you talked about how a lot of this stuff was born out of you trying to raise support for Avatar The Last Airbender. You go to Tumblr and there's F yeah this and F yeah that, people sharing GIFs of their favorite Doctor Who episodes and creating fan art and even fan fiction. And this is kind of another contribution in a new way to this kind of idea of generating support and enthusiasm around an intellectual property. But is this... Fandom of the 21st century? Does like an intellectual property need this kind of thing in order to get critical mass support? Oh, Dave, did you freeze? Are you there, Dave? Well, yep. Oh. See, this is why I'm glad we have an in-studio guest.
That's right.
Bips in and out all the time. I think he had to go get something to drink. I'll turn it to you, Kevin. What do you think about that?
I'm sorry, say it again.
Well, this whole idea of what's the line on being a supportive fan of an intellectual property, like, because you were not endorsed by Nickelodeon when you did this, right?
No, not at all.
Mm-hmm. I mean, so what's the line between being an enthusiastic supporter and being somebody who's trying to capitalize on somebody else's intellectual property? I know that's kind of a dicey question.
That is. I think the line is mostly, are you trying to make profit off of it?
Uh-huh.
Do you know what I mean? A lot of what the fans do, they don't make profit. In fact, I know a lot of fans, especially for the panels, and I should mention at this point that my good friend she goes by the name Avatar Mom online. She's been organizing these fan panels all across all these various anime conventions around the country. And this year we finally had our own fan panel at San Diego Comic-Con, along with the official panel that went on. And we like to have a comp student contest during these panels, and we give away prizes. And we've been lucky enough in recent years to have Dark Horse be a major contributor. And they've donated comics to the panels and things, and they've donated, we've had a lot of the kind of neat official things that we've had. Folks like Dave and Johan Matt, one of the storyboard artists from the show, do like, autographs and doodles in the comics and whatnot. But a lot of the prizes that we've given out, too, have been fan-made crafts and, presents.
Wow.
And the fans do that for free. They don't, get any money in return. They do it because they love it. They love their fellow fans, and they want to do it because they enjoy the show so much.
Wow. This is such a – this is, and we got Dave back, I think. Dave?
Yeah, I'm back.
Okay, cool. Awesome. This is such a reversal on the idea of the comic book guy from The Simpsons who says, as a loyal fan, you owe me entertainment.
Right. Yeah.
What changed? How did this come about? Because you think about what's going on with DC Comics right now, and I don't want to go into it too deeply. Everybody knows about Superman's wearing armor now and has a collar, and they're rebooting the continuity, and everybody's mad. and I'm not saying they're wrong to be mad. I'm just saying that there's the situation, mm-hmm. and it comes around these circles of fan entitlement, and then you know trying to reboot the thing over and over again to appease this certain group of people. But here we have something like what's going on with you and the Puppetbenders mm-hmm. and Avatar, yeah. where it's this kind of joyous giving back to the thing you love. What do you guys attribute that to? What changed?
I don't know if anything's changed. I think that technology, obviously, now the connection yeah. of the fans mm-hmm. is different. Like when comic books had fans and they had fandoms, and you know, going to San Diego Comic-Con is really enlightening because you learn about the history of the Comic-Con. Especially going to the Eisner Awards, you learn about how fanzines and you know really did contribute. Like Paul Levitz, who was the CEO of DC Comics for a long time, like he got his start from fanzines. He was someone who made fan, you know, like zines about comics, and then eventually ended up working in comics. And I don't think that's too different from what's going on now and here, where, you know, fans are really passionate about the material, and then they want to sort of, you know, participate and create things, and then some of them end up working, you know, in the industry that mm-hmm. they were once fans of.
Yeah.
And some people are happy just to remain fans mm-hmm. and just create fan works.
Yeah.
I think the big difference with Avatar, or The Last Airbender, as I guess we should call it, now is that it's still a personal creation.
Yeah.
I think that's the same thing with something like Harry Potter mm-hmm. Or even Twilight, is that there's still 1 to 3 people sort of really responsible for these things. And
right.
it's still mm-hmm. coming out under the creator's vision. So
yes.
there is this sort of relationship with a single creator mm-hmm. or a creative entity, rather than something like DC Comics or Marvel Comics, which at this point are being just sort of, you know, they're franchises that are being shepherded by specific people, but it's constantly being passed from person to person. And depending on who that person is, can really reboot it or reimagine it.
Mm-hmm.
So it doesn't, I feel like it's less personal and it's more...
corporate.
Although, yeah, it's definitely more corporate. I mean, sometimes they are. I mean, and that's not to dismiss the work itself.
No,
I think
no.
that... a lot of people come to these superheroes with a lot of passion and love for them. I don't
sure.
think Grant Morrison, when he takes on a superhero, you know, I think he does it with reverence and love for those characters and tries to do the best job he can. But, you know, in 2 months, he may be replaced by somebody else.
Do you think that something like Avatar is a step in the right direction because it's the next series, The Legend of Korra, for those who haven't heard, mm-hmm. It follows the continuity of what happened after
right.
the first series, but
right.
it's decades after that. It
mm-hmm.
doesn't, it's not necessarily going to feature all of the original characters
no.
that we know and love, right?
As far as we know, not at all.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, I mean, do you think that protects it from a little bit of that sort of like fan entitlement of continuity and wanting to keep the status quo? And they've invented a series that they could just build on forever and reinvent
oh, yeah.
around
mm-hmm.
every corner, right?
No, yeah. It's absolutely brilliant.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I'm really excited. I mean, I think that was what I wish they had done with the Star Wars prequels. I wish they could have done those as, you know, even further removed from the original
yeah.
trilogy, so that you weren't sitting there trying to connect every little dot. You
right.
weren't
mm-hmm.
trying to say, oh, this guy is this person's father and this person's this. I think there is going to be a little bit of that with the new Last Airbender series, but not, you know, to the same extent.
No.
As
so
when, like,
we don't think...
Yeah.
We don't think old Sokka is going to show up in the new series.
I'm sure want it for sure.
I mean, that's fan service, right? They're bound to have a walk on.
I'd love to see a geriatric Sokka try to throw his boomerang.
I want to see a geriatric Toph, because I know she'll be the crankiest old woman that you've ever seen in your life.
Well, I don't know how many people have been online to see this or know this, but Toph's, was it her daughter?
Yeah, her daughter.
Is featured in the show. Yeah, her adult daughter is now in the show, and she's chief of police in the main Republic City.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I haven't seen any of the new
stuff. Oh, you haven't seen any of the
all
new stuff.
All I've seen
okay.
is a picture of Korra on that weird dog bear thing.
I got to tell you. I got a real funny story about that, about the whole Avatar panel. I don't know if I'm going to get into the whole story, the whole
go
panel.
Ahead.
But when they announced, Mike and Brian were up there, and they were showing the slideshow about all the different designs they had, and they had Toph's daughter come up. Do you remember her name at all? I can't remember the...
I don't remember.
Yeah,
name.
Said it in brief, but... they had her picture come up there and they explained who she was. The first thing somebody shouted out loud was, "Who's the daddy?" To which I think they replied, "I didn't hear that."
That is a
good
question.
I wasn't actually at the panel, but that was one of the first just anecdotes that I heard from people. You know, and I have to say, I was a little disappointed. Like, I was just like, it always comes back to shipping.
It always comes back to shipping. Exactly.
It always comes back.
Relationships over everything else.
Oh, yeah, shipping. Really. Oh.
Shipping. Oh, yeah. No, that's the thing. You know, some guys like the kung fu action.
Yeah.
Other folks, especially, I know a lot of the girls in the fandom, it's either, you know, it's all about the romance.
Yeah, yeah.
So, not all girls, not all guys. I'm not saying.
Or both. You know, when the whole, you know, what's the statute of limitations on this in terms of talking about the original series? Because I still have friends who have not seen the original series all the way through.
Oh no. Okay.
And you know,
it's their fault. We can spoil anything they want. No.
Well, but Legend of Korra is sort of a spoiler in and of itself,
yes,
isn't it? Because just the premise of her being the daughter of two characters from the original series.
Well, how can I put this, guys? It's Nickelodeon. No one's going to die. So you know, you know the characters at the end of the series are not going to be too beat up, but
yeah, that's true. Didn't some people died? I thought, yeah,
it was very vague.
Oh, that's true. Okay,
that was something at the fan panel we had. We had John O'Brien, one of the writers in the show, on our fan panel,
mm-hmm.
and he talked about that fact. About somebody asked him, "Well, was there some things that they told you couldn't do it during the show?" You got like notes back from Nickelodeon saying, no, specifically take that out. And he said, actually, they didn't, because they kind of knew what the rules and the guidelines were. Like, you know, you can have lots of sword fights, but you can't have anybody getting stabbed or skewered or anything like that.
Okay.
You could.
Well, that's funny because Azula was, I think, one of the most, absolutely menacing and frightening.
Absolutely.
And when she's doing that lightning stuff.
And what was brilliant about that is they made her menacing without being violent. I mean, you know, without being graphically violent. Let's put it that way. You know
what
I mean?
That's true. Yeah.
And, but basically they said that they couldn't say the word kill.
Okay.
But they could say, I think they could say pass away or something like that or something, you know. But again, like things like it was, should I spoil it?
Okay, so we'll give a spoiler alert. If you're the kind of person that cannot enjoy a story unless you are surprised by everything that happens in the story, mm-hmm. then maybe you should skip ahead like about 3 minutes.
Ears and fingers, la, 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 la.
Yeah, that's a, right. So yes,
yeah,
Jet.
No, Jet, yeah, poor Jet, yeah. Well, we don't really know. I mean, frankly, the way they did it, everybody says, yes, of course, he's dead, but mm-hmm. they, you know, the way it was shown, you could very easily leave it up. I think they even mentioned the panel, they said, it's kind of like a Boba Fett thing. If you really wanted to come back, I guess he could.
Okay, yeah, yeah. And that's another thing that's so great about the show is that they can balance between dealing with an issue like that delicately, but then they can go to bloodbending.
Yeah, right.
Which is like the creepiest thing I've ever seen.
Uh-huh.
But when it happened, I was like, oh, it makes perfect sense. Of course you'd be able to do that, but who would thought of that? That's creepy. So, where was I going with this? This whole idea of what's going to happen in the next series, it itself is a spoiler.
Yes, but...
And then there's going to be fan demand for...
The fan artwork that popped up right after this weekend online. If you go on DeviantArt, you go to any other webpage that's, you know, following the Avatar fandom, it exploded. Because why? Beforehand, all we had, of course, is we had a picture of Korra from behind, standing behind looking at the city, okay? Then we had a picture of her from the front doing like this number, right? But you never... The problem with the... Here's the thing. I'll burst in. I know I'm kind of getting ahead of myself. If you look at the Korra puppet here, I was really nervous when I was making the Korra puppet because I'm like, I'm going to go through all this work and I still don't know what some of these colors are. There was an animatic that was actually leaked online of her fighting somebody, and you probably saw that, right?
Yeah.
And that was the only way I knew she had like this little apron flap on the bottom half on the front side here.
Yeah.
And I had no idea what color that was. And I said, well, maybe it's the brown. The first time we finally found out was at the signing at the Nickelodeon booth. Nickelodeon hired a cosplayer. A person to come dressed as Korra.
I saw a picture of that.
Probably think the pictures on that. I mean, she was really good. They did a great job with that. And I looked at her costume because I was studying. I'm like, okay, what did I do wrong? And all the other girls who had come dressed as Korra too, they're like, what did we do wrong? What did we miss? And then we looked and I saw her flap. It's like, it's dark blue. No! You know. And then I looked and we could never see her collar in front before. And she has this notched V-neck collar. I'm like, no! We all have to redo our puppets and cosplay.
So this is Korra 1.0.
This is Korra 1.0. Exactly. But now we have, at the panel, we saw all these other character designs.
Yeah.
And which we'd never seen before. And so, boom, now everybody can go out and do tons of fan art and all sorts of things about all these new characters we're going to have.
But again, they're already speculating, like, who hooks up with who. And, you know.
Oh, maybe disturbingly so, too.
Oh, that's what I was going to say earlier, is that I was worried about spoilers, was I was really as a dude who really likes the fire and the lightning, I thought Azula was one of the best characters in the series. It was just fun to watch her go completely crazy. But when they were starting to hint at the whole Toph and Sokka thing, that I was sitting on the edge of my seat about that, you know? That was super, super sweet. They deal with all the romance with a really light touch, so it doesn't come off as being too, you know, it's not too chest-pounding, you know?
No. Mm-hmm.
So I expect that they'll do that again with this series, right?
I'm sure.
But what else did we find out? I mean, because I'm the blank slate here. Okay, I don't know what they've revealed so far. I saw the pictures of some dude with a nutty mask. And
oh yeah, that's apparently the new bad guy. He is a leader of a group of, what do they call them, Dave? Do you remember specifically?
The equalists or something.
Equalists, right? They're non-benders that are leading a movement against people who bend. Ah. It's sort of a people of privilege.
Okay.
It's sort of an underground terrorist movement, I guess you could say, against them. Hmm. And the thing is, they're all. Do you remember Ty Lee?
Oh yeah, yeah.
Yeah, of course. You know how she had that technique of blocking the chi points in the body that prevents someone from bending. Mm-hmm. They have almost an entire black ops group of chi blockers actually. So they're non benders, but they know how to block the chi points to stop the benders from being a threat.
Very cool.
So yeah, no, they're really amping up their game in this one, and I'm looking at it. And I'm thinking, my gosh, I'm gonna make new puppets for all this stuff. I gotta amp my game up too. we gotta make something cooler looking. You know? I like the round football shaped head that I made, but maybe I should make something a little more detailed or advanced because everything's gone up. The drawing, the art level. Who is their main art designer that they had? Dave, do you remember his name? I'm so bad at names. I'm really terrible. He was the fella from Korea.
I want to give a shout out to Eric in the chat room, who's actually helping out with the show today. He's posting links to everything that we're talking about in the chat. So there, thank you, Eric, for doing that. And for those who show up on the show live, you don't have to wait for the show notes now. Pretty awesome. Okay, but anyway, the art director from Avatar, are we looking that up?
But he was, just the designs he was coming up with were truly phenomenal, and they're even more, I want to say, kind of anime based. I mean, they've preserved the look of the previous series. In the face and all that. They didn't go too far into a new look or a new animated type of look, but it's all the characters are older now, of course. They're not all 14. They look to be, either late teens or some in the 20s. And so just the designs and everything. And the world is now more actually, it's 70 years in the future. You know how it was kind of like a sort of Asian, sort of China in the kind of, I don't want to say, I don't know my periods of Chinese history, but it was obviously, long, long ago.
Right.
They're moving more towards, and I think they described it as a 1920s New Orleans Chinese-infused steampunk world.
Oh, interesting.
So, the Fire Nation had all this technology that you saw in the first series.
Oh, that's right. They did.
It's kind of like they're on the brink of technological revolution, industrial revolution. And so that's all come into play now. Now it looks like the 1920s, there's these steampunk cars and airships, and there's really advanced cities and things.
That is absolutely daring. I mean, from a storyteller standpoint of somebody who's sitting on a very popular intellectual property, that is absolutely daring.
Especially when it had such a distinct theme and look in that direction, to go ahead and do something almost completely different.
Mm-hmm.
And at the first, I was kind of like, I don't know if I like that. What are they? Steampunk?
That's the term.
Are we going to have crossover fandoms with the steampunks now? But once I saw it, I was like, this is so cool.
Yeah.
What they have done with it is so cool. The way they've infused it just looks awesome.
Yeah. They're really talented people behind it, for one. And
absolutely.
I think a singular vision of the core group creators, like you were talking about, Dave, right? That helps a lot, doesn't it? Oh, we lost Dave's audio. Hold on a second. What happened to your audio, Dave? I think we muted you by accident, perhaps. Oh. Huh. Interesting.
Hmm.
Let me see. There we go. Dave? No, we're still not hearing you.
Hmm.
And maybe we got a loose connection in the back here.
Uh-oh.
There we go. We're getting some...
Puppet Zuko, I think, made of...
Hey, Dave?
Yeah, can you hear me now?
Yes, there we can hear you. Yes, Zuko got involved.
That was my fault. That's right. So, subterfuge.
I was talking trash. You didn't want to hear
Yeah, you got it.
So speaking of spoilers, Zuko, how do you feel about Korra being the daughter of Aang and Katara when it should have been the daughter of you and Katara?
She's not, though. I don't think she is, actually. I think she's unrelated.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh, enlighten me, because I thought it was the daughter of Aang.
Korra is the reincarnation of Aang's avatar spirit, basically. So she does not, just like Aang was born to the air, the air monks.
Right.
He has died, and I guess the avatar spirit is now passed on to the next one in the cycle, which is the water tribe.
Okay.
So she's kind of his reincarnation.
Sure.
What we do learn, though, is that there is a character named Tenzin who is the son of Katara and Aang.
Okay, that's what I was mixing it up. Yeah.
Korra, when we start the series, has learned the three elements of water, earth and fire, but she hasn't learned airbending because he is pretty much the only airbender that's left. And he, of course, actually was revealed in some really hilarious fan art, if you can go online and find it. He has a wife and he has three kids with a fourth on the way, actually. And they're all these really cute crazy kids that are that he's training as airbenders.
I've seen some of mm-hmm. the art for this. So, okay. Yeah.
So you're right. The fangirls were not happy. Well, some of the fangirls were, you know, whatever camp was in. You know how shipping has names? Have you ever heard that before?
I've not heard that. This is a new term for
okay,
me.
Okay, for those who don't know, when you ship something, you find the cutest way to take the first name of one character and the second name of another character and combine it.
Yeah.
So Zuko and Katara, I spoiled it, became Zutara.
Right.
You know, Katara and Aang became Katang, actually. And then you would do other names and combinations like that.
Yeah.
But out of all the shippers, I would say those were the two that were locked in mortal, you know, combat the hardest, I suppose.
I still talk to some of my young students who are still bitter about that.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, to this day. You know, it's like the Civil War to them. Yeah. You know, the South shall rise again.
People ask me all the time, like, what are my thoughts on that? And I just have to say no comment because I keep, you know, my head keeps getting squished in when if I say the wrong thing, you know?
So. Sorry, you made me snort. I've got a question from the chat room here. How does one become a puppeteer? Any thoughts on that? I mean, you jumped into it. You just dove right
in.
Yeah,
yeah. Well, you know, I actually, puppetry was something I'd always, you know, played around with since I was a young kid, of course. And even when I was in college, I went to the Art Institute of Pittsburgh. We wound up, for whatever reason, I don't know why, it just sort of serendipitously sort of came out this way. We had to do video assignments where we would go and do, let's say, like a tour of the Children's Museum in Pittsburgh. And we're like, well, who do we want to host this this video? And we're like, let's just make it a puppet. That's so much cooler to look at than a person talking to the camera. So we would go ahead, slap that together, and we would do, like, you know, a puppet's hosting this video and all that. So I kind of got the one thing that I guess I got skilled at was just, you know, having fun as a kid with puppets, you know, looking at them playing in the mirror and getting used to opening and closing the mouth right because
– Syncing it, yeah.
Syncing it because sometimes you'll see, you know, folks who put on a puppet for the first time and they'll – as I'm talking, they'll kind of just do that, you know what I mean,
as they're
talking. And you really got to get used to making your hand flap with the syllables and really kind of learning to turn your hand to give it expression. And
there's you're doing a lot with your wrists, too.
You are, right, exactly.
You're overacting to
you're
make up.
Yeah, very much so, yes.
Yeah. And you can see it on your face, too. That's probably something else people have to – because there were pictures. Dave posted some pictures of you from the workshop you did at the Ann Arbor District Library.
If it wasn't so funny, I'd be like, oh, that's terrible.
But that's what happens when you're overacting, right? Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Exactly.
So I guess like a comfort with yourself you have to
Absolutely. Yeah. You know what's something really interesting, too, I noticed, though? You know, there's some puppeteers, I say professional performers or puppeteers out there, who they treat the puppet when they perform. And this is sort of an art form, and I'm not saying anything bad against this because this is just a certain style. But they'll treat the puppet like it's a real creature. Mm-hmm. And they might do some ventriloquy. And when they want to put the puppet away or do something else, they'll say, okay, well, he has to go to sleep now. We're going to put him in his house.
Uh-huh.
Okay, so they preserve the illusion. And that's kind of, like I said, a neat art form in that. But for me, and I know for some other puppeteers, and I think even Jim Henson said it's an arm sock, basically. It's a tool.
Yeah.
And the funny thing that I discovered, especially interesting story about that, the one that I brought up about in Pittsburgh there, kids, when they see a puppeteer, they don't see that. They don't see you. They see the puppet. When I was there in the Children's Museum and we were doing the video, we were doing our setup, and I was kind of laying on the floor on my back and I had the puppet up over my head. A mother and her child came by, and the child instantly, boom, little boy ran over to the puppet, gave it a hug, and started talking to him. And I'm laying there on the floor. He can see me.
Yeah.
He can see my mouth moving and talking. He didn't care. I didn't exist in the world to him.
Right.
You know what I mean? So there's a certain magic there that I think, especially for kids, you don't necessarily need to hide yourself or hide that illusion.
And even adults to some degree. I remember seeing Jim Henson on The Tonight Show years ago. It was back when Johnny Carson was still on the show.
Yeah.
And he said something to the same degree where Johnny Carson said, like, I noticed that you don't try to hide the fact that your lips are moving. He's like, well, nobody's looking at me.
Right.
They're looking at Kermit.
That's right.
And then he instantly started having Kermit talk to Johnny Carson. And Johnny Carson just naturally started talking with Kermit and, like, bypassing Jim Henson altogether.
Exactly, yeah.
So, yeah, that is one of the neat things about puppetry, too, is that it plays on the cartoon, doesn't it?
I mean, that
investment draws you into the character. So, yeah. What other things about Avatar: The Last Airbender, The Legend of Korra, that it was exciting that we should know about? What are you guys looking forward to?
Dave?
Mm-hmm. Everything. I think it just looks like a lot of fun, and I think that's something that I really liked about the original show is that it never took itself too seriously, even when it was sort of entrenched in the drama of it. It really has that nice balance of fun, and the shots that I've seen of the new series looks like exactly the same. You know, the fact that they decided to make Tenzin, you know, this like father with like this like these little ragamuffin kids, and like you know, the pregnant wife, like instantly you can see the comedy that's going to come out of that. Mm-hmm. You know,
That was something I was going to bring up, because when you started talking about it looking more anime, maybe more steampunk, I thought, oh dear, here we go again, aging up. Right? This is the thing that, you know, the Thundercats thing that's coming out looks great, but every time one of these things gets revisited or revised, if the new guy comes in, it's like, let's take it and make it aim it at 20-year-olds, you know?
Right, right.
And, you know, what you're talking about here really sort of, like, relieves my beating heart a little bit that I would be distressed if it went totally into, you know, Ninja Scroll
territory. Exactly, yeah. I mean, it's Nickelodeon. There should be booger and fart jokes. Okay. Absolutely. That's what makes it fun.
Oh, that's a good way to put it. Booger and fart jokes.
They're great at that.
So
slime. Forever.
Always green slime. Yeah, right. You have to have that in some way, shape, or form.
You can't do that on television. Yeah. That kind of thing. Yeah. Okay. Well, I don't want to belabor the point too much. I do want to ask though. So you're going to be doing new Puppetbender shows?
Yes,
for
yes, we are. Absolutely.
What do you got planned?
We haven't done them in a long time, almost a year. In fact, we left everybody on a cliffhanger. We made. I did a little video. You might have seen it on there. It's the last one that we had. It's called "Where Are They Now?"
Right.
Because the show had ended, and it was kind of like a presentation. I was supposed to make like e-television, and what happened to all the characters? Where they went and moved on to jobs from? And we were going to finish it up with part two, where we went into the other characters, which I think was Zuko and Toph and Aang. And I never got around to doing that one yet because, number one, I got into so much work. I started getting work offers from other folks like Macmillan Publishing. We've done trailers for them now for their young adult novels. And actually,
no fooling.
For Dave's Astronaut Academy book that came out, we did the trailer that you might be able to see online.
I've seen it.
I did the animation for that and the sound work and whatnot. So I've actually been getting a lot of paid work for doing videos and doing fan things as well. So, but that doesn't satisfy all the people on YouTube. And I understand that. I get messages all the time. Why aren't the new videos coming out? And I would write these long explanations saying, well, I'm getting work now, and there's this and I'm happening in my life. And I don't care. Come on, make the videos already. And I deeply sympathize because I want to see them too. And we will, and it's an absolute promise. I told everybody at the fan panel, Puppet Korra, we have a whole new generation now to take charge. We're going to be doing a lot more videos. And the thing is too, with the show off the air, it's kind of hard to come up with fun jokes because, like I said, all the humor was based at sort of the fandom's reaction to the show. Yeah. And we haven't had a show to kind of, make jokes about.
Yeah, when does it come out anyway?
Oh, that's a... Did you hear that one at the panel day when they said that? They had that very same question asked to them and they said, we don't know. And the only reason is because he said, look, it's like a plane on the tarmac. Everything's loaded. We're ready to go. We're just waiting our turn. There's other shows that are in the schedule that need to, come out first and get on Nickelodeon's schedule. But as soon as they have that date for sure, they'll let everybody know.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. But as you're saying, you are going to go ahead, Dave.
Mm-hmm. I just want to give Kevin a little bit more credit than just the idea that the puppet videos are just about parodying the show. I think one of the things that's really entertaining about them, especially with the Where Are They Now, is that they also lampoon pop culture in general. There's a lot of stuff outside of the Avatar fandom that is parodied in those videos. That it's they really are brilliant, and I can see that because I did not make them.
Yeah,
they're so much fun to watch,
and I agree.
And I think some people might want to just say, oh, it's just for the fans. It's just you got to be an Avatar fan to enjoy them. But I think they do. They have a wide appeal.
Oh, thank you.
I think because of the crossover with general pop culture jokes too, is you could look at them as a great primer for getting into Avatar, like getting a sense of the spirit of the series,
absolutely.
Right? You know, so. So maybe you should watch it before you watch Avatar: The Last Airbender. There we go. Okay, well, new episodes to come, and in terms of people, clamoring for more, that is always flattering, but it is frustrating at the same time. We just finished looking at our reviews of Kids Read Comics, the event that you guys were both at last June. What is it called? Like when you send a survey out to get people's sense of it. And there's a couple people who wrote more free stuff, please. free events, free stuff to give away.
More
we put
free
everything.
Stuff.
This. Please give me more. That's always like the penalty of success when you do something well.
True.
You're like, give me more. Okay, well, as soon as I can.
Well, I joke with somebody. I said, you said do the puppet videos now. I said, well, if you could pay me to do them, I'd do them right away. Really quickly. But I don't mean to be that cynical. It's like I really love doing it, and I really want to keep doing it.
But you
have
responsibilities.
We have other responsibilities.
One last thought on this, and I want to summarize this point on the puppet vendors, both in terms of fan art, but also in terms of doing demoing your ability to be a content creator for other people, mm-hmm. right? The neat thing about this is I'm betting you don't have a $2 million studio set up to make these videos.
No.
I mean, could you describe what kind of setup you work with? Because, I mean, you sure. make these puppets yourself.
Yeah. Yes, I absolutely do. So, number one, of course, the internet is a fantastic resource for figuring out how to do these things. Mm-hmm. Like I said, for the original New York one, I found out within a week the best way to make professional puppets. And you can do that just through Google searching. You can find patterns. You can find ideas. And the materials, like, I never knew about Antron fleece before, which is the fleece which is used for, like, Muppet skin.
Okay.
Because it's used because it helps hide the seams and all. So, you know, of course, the internet was a fantastic resource. But the things that I had at my disposal, of course, from the job that I have, were just, you know, some basic light kits. We had a green screen, you know, foldable green screen that we have. We have a camera setup and just the basic things that you would have in a very minimal studio setup. And everything else was just filmed in my basement.
Okay.
Or if we had, like, an outdoor shoot, we'd just go in my backyard where the woods are at. You know what I mean? So it was literally, it's just all in the house. I don't really have a studio. The place where I work even doesn't have a studio. Whenever we have to do setups or we have to have interviews or things like that, we do it in kind of a makeshift conference room.
Yeah.
And break up and set down. So you don't really need to have a gigantic production facility to make these sorts of things happen.
Yeah, a green screen is like $100 maybe.
Yeah, exactly.
And then like a couple soft boxes, mm-hmm. Light boxes, or rather like those right. Photography lights, that's like another $100, right?
Right, exactly. And you can, you know, you can obviously go to the highest level possible and have things like the, they're called, I think, Diva lights, KinoFlow yeah. Diva lights, which are kind of these really cool things which
sure.
we have. But you don't need that. You could even use shop lights, you know, from Home Depot
yeah.
to be able to light your scene. Oh, one thing I wanted to mention too, you talk about having a studio or you talk about fan collaboration as well. I got in contact on DeviantArt with this fantastic artist from Australia. And for the one video where, I believe it's called, about the, it's not over till the something lady sings or something. It's a terrible, I don't remember my own video name. It's been so long. but it's the one where the guys, we in the first video, remember I told you I only made the three guys initially? We threw a joke in there why the girls weren't there. Because Mattel back in the day had never made
yes.
the female characters from the Avatar toys. And everybody was just irate about that. And so I tried to turn that in my favor, and I made a quick joke about that in the first video about, like, you know, where's the girls? There's no girls. Just ask Mattel.
Then rimshot, and they look at the camera.
Yeah. But I eventually wanted to have the girls to show up because everybody asked for it. And so this video, I thought, okay, I'll make the girls show up, but I won't show them till the last 2 seconds, even though I made them. And so the whole video, they're all kind of, like, gibbering with each other with these paper bag versions of the girls. And I knew the setting that I wanted to have it was the time, the place that the show left off in the middle of the third season. They were at the Western, was it the Western Air Temple or the Eastern?
I think it was Western.
Western, okay. So the Western Air Temple where they're at. And I found this fantastic girl on DeviantArt who was doing this backdrop artwork, and she was doing scenery, and she was an Avatar fan. And I asked her, and I said, would you mind doing a high-res painting illustration, digital illustration for me of the Western Air Temple? And I gave her a quick little sketch of the angle that I wanted and the look, and I sent it to her, and she went and she made it, and it was just phenomenal. And I had it printed out huge, you know, from a big poster store, and we actually made a frame. We set that up as our backdrop for the puppet stage for that little episode.
Wow.
And we performed in front of it, and it looks like you're actually there at a location. Or people think, oh, did you do a green screen for that? We didn't.
Wow.
We actually just we printed up a backdrop that a fan made, again, for free, because she loved it. You know,
yeah.
we all loved it. We all wanted to contribute and do something. We all promised, of course, to promote each other and
sure.
the work that we do, and
well,
there
I mean,
we had it.
There you go. I mean, that you talk about doing stuff for free, but that is part of the
yes.
commerce system of the internet is
right.
links. Right?
Yes, absolutely.
Let's talk about at the top when Raina mm-hmm. was on here, how she said one of the chief things that she attributes to, you know, the success with Smile was sharing links on the internet,
yes.
Twitter, Facebook, et cetera, right? So, I mean, that is a form of currency that can't be overlooked in this
oh, no.
kind of fan creation work.
Definitely.
So.
But you know what I find even more interesting? I mean, I think it's awesome that some fans are creating these things, and then it's sort of like, okay, maybe it's leading to some sort of payment in the end, or they're getting work out of it. And I'm certainly someone who's always trying to help mm-hmm. people as much as possible. What I'm most impressed by is certain parts of fandom where it really is a nonprofit thing every step of the way.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And one of the things, like on the last episode, we were talking about Harry Potter that I felt I didn't get a chance to really mention, is the Harry Potter Alliance, which is like this huge nonprofit organization that's come out of this idea that, you know, fans of Harry Potter, you know, had time on their hands and were, you know, wanted to use their sort of their fandom in a sort of positive way to sort of affect the world. And they've created this amazing nonprofit organization that like helps all these charities and does all this amazing pro-social work, all in the name of Harry Potter. Like they're embodying the spirit of what they think are the themes of these books. And I'm actually, you know, surprised that Avatar hasn't like led to a little bit more of that, considering that, you know, at its core, it's this really great Buddhist story about like, you know, a Kung Fu Dalai Lama.
Like maybe a dance school based on that episode where Aang does the Footloose episode in the Fire Nation. Aang taught us how to dance and therefore how to love, so I'm going to start dance school.
Do the dragon dance.
So, okay, well, cool. I think we covered a lot of stuff today. Yeah. And I know Sharon Iverson is waiting to come in. I'm bummed out that we didn't get to talk to Toph because that is easily my favorite people who are listening to this podcast after the fact. Really, watch the video because you're missing out when you see these puppets.
Oh, I love puppet Toph. She's got such attitude. She could take down Naruto any day.
That's right. That video is on the channel too, right? She and Naruto.
Yeah, kind of spar off between each other. And that was kind of an in joke in the fandom as well too. So that's right. If I talk with her, she has a man voice too. Yeah, we need ADR artists, and we do get them. So.
No, I think Toph would be pleased. Remember the episode where they did the play?
Oh, that's right. Hear me roar, I see with my voice.
And she was delighted.
She was.
She's the only character who loved her play version of herself, which is also, that's another one that people should watch for when they watch the Puppetbender series, is what a great way to do a clip show. I've said it before, I'll say it again. That was brilliant. The most brilliant clip show I've ever seen in my life. Okay, well, Final Cut, it would be the last part of your studio setup, right?
Yes, Final Cut and After Effects are the two things that I use. After Effects for doing things like stick and wire removals or anything that was kind of, you know, strange in the backdrop. And we also have done a lot of things like fire effects when the characters actually bend. I had Zuko bending fire a couple times, and we had flames shooting out. And, you know, After Effects is kind of a quick – and we demonstrated that actually at Kids Read Comics.
You did.
About kind of very basic form, you know, kind of very rough form of how to do that.
I noticed that some of your explosions came from Demolition Studios.
Yes, they did.
Which is run by Bob Forward, who was one of the head writers of Beast Wars. So.
No kidding. I didn't know that.
That's the business he started up after
God
Beast Wars.
God bless him. I've loved those things.
Yeah. I thought it was terrific that the writer who was known for doing all the episodes of the Big Guns and Explosions started a company where he sells explosion special effects.
Yeah, right. And so, like I said, those things are out there to find if you want to use them. You can make very professional work.
Yeah, that's so cool. Well, thank you for the inspiration. So and no, for sure, man. And you are welcome back anytime to promote the latest episodes of the series and if any new puppets come out that we have to see. So
definitely.
Anything else that you want to point people at today?
Just keep watching for the fan panels that we're hosting. AvatarLegacy.com is where they get announced and posted, Avatar Legacy. And like I said, hopefully we'll be back at Comic-Con next year and a couple of other conventions around the area, especially Chicago C2E2. We've been going back to a couple years in a row now, so it's a lot of fun. We like to highlight... We do sometimes like to have folks from the show, like John O'Brien and Ian Graham, who are our guests this year. But we really do like to focus on the fans and what they're doing with their artwork. Our panel had a couple of really great fan artists this year, Isaiah and Booter Freak, who fans are really familiar with their hilarious artwork and work. So check us out if we get a chance.
Okay. Well, cool. Mm-hmm. C2E2. Oh, we'll put that in the show notes, too. So, sure. Dave, how's do you have any kind of sense of how Astronaut Academy is doing yet? No?
Since last week.
Hey, reviews. Reviews, right? So did you get any new reviews on Amazon or on the Goodreads? I just posted a review on Goodreads, too, thinking like, oh, yeah, that's probably a good idea, people using that.
Yeah, I love Goodreads. It's a lot of fun.
Are you on there?
Yeah.
I'll have to find you.
Yep.
But I was actually going to use that as an opportunity to tell people if you're on the Goodreads, give a review for Dave for Astronaut Academy because we got to get you the Eisner next year, right?
Sure, I'll take it.
That's the year they're going to make it out of plastic, though. It's going to be like a Cap'n Crunch prize with by the time you get one.
That's right. Or I'll take a puppet Eisner.
Actually, that's the other thing I wanted to say is that we need to get a Dave Roman puppet because when the first couple episodes we did of Comics Are Great together, Dave was expressing dismay at managing his face on a screen and his voice on a mic at the same time. And how much easier would that be if we had a Dave Roman puppet? Yeah, let's make it so. Let's start a pool. Let's start a PayPal pool to pay Kevin to make one. So then Dave can actually have a walk on one of the Puppetbender cartoons as well.
That'd be sweet.
Or puppet shows rather. Okay, well, I think we're going to switch over to get Sharon in here so we can get our book review.
Okay.
And this will give Dave a chance to... Oh, thanks again, Kevin Coppa.
You are absolutely welcome.
I want to give you one more last shout out for youtube.com/cornersphere, K-O-R-N-E-R, sphere. And then, Dave, what do you got that's worth promoting, shouting about, besides Astronaut Academy? You got other stuff going on. Oh, and I think I lost you. Oh. Still there?
Did you lose me or am I?
No, you're still here.
Hello?
Still got you.
Yeah, I think I'm.
Awesome.
Yes. It's hard to tell because it's usually a delay. There's in the spirit of Avatar, there Dark Horse Comics just published the Avatar: The Last Airbender, The Lost Adventures, which are all of.
Oh, you blipped out there, Dave. You blipped out. Okay, give me that again. It's the Dark Horse book.
Avatar, The Last Airbender, The Lost Adventures from Dark Horse Comics. And it's all the Avatar comics that I edited originally for Nick Magazine, now all in a travel-sized collection that is beautifully printed.
Oh, cool. All right, so is that linked on theatime.com, or do we just do a search on Amazon for that?
You should probably just look on Amazon for that. And I guess I would also give a shout out to, if you're a fan of Avatar The Last Airbender and you're looking for a great webcomic, I would check out Delilah Dirk and the Turkish Lieutenant by Tony Cliff.
Mm.
It's a really beautifully drawn series, sort of like historical fiction, but with action adventure and humor and all the stuff that if you liked Avatar The Last Airbender, you'll probably enjoy that webcomic.
Okay, cool. Thanks, Dave. I want to give you a chance for any final thoughts because, you know, I cut you off last time before we could get to everything. I stepped all over you, and and that's why you had to bring in that Harry Potter thing this time with the Harry Potter Alliance. Any final thoughts on this whole thing about fandom, fan art, Avatar? No?
Not at the moment. I'm sure I'll sprinkle little things across the future episodes.
Well, you know you have an open-door policy on this show, so if you forget anything, you can always just pop in real quick and say, hey, last week I wanted to say this, and then you can just go. Get back to work on Astronaut Academy Book 2.
I think I was just more upset that I pronounced J.K. Rowling's name wrong several times last week.
Is it Rowling or Rowling?
It's Rowling like bowling.
Okay.
And I did know that, but... I got too excited, and I believe it's Mary Grand Prix, not Marie Grand Prix, but what do I know? I'm just a fan.
Okay, so now I'm going to turn to Sharon Iverson of the Ann Arbor District Library, AEDL.org. You are a teen librarian.
That's right.
And so you manage, you manage a lot of the comics events that is going on here, and as well as the teen collection. What do you got for us today? Are we doing calendar or are we doing book recommendations?
It's whichever way you want to go at this point.
I'll let you decide. You're the major domo of comics programming.
You know, while
here.
Dave's on, I have to give a shout out to, of course, his book, Astronaut Academy, which I'm in the process of rereading a second time. It was so much fun. And because of this book, I went into our catalog to see what else we had of yours. And this was not in our branch, the branch I work in. But I also brought in a shout out for the Jax Epoch books.
She's gone to school.
Yeah, and I can tell that you and Raina work in different creative spheres, with yours being much more fantastical and hers more realistic. So, yeah, absolutely. Both of them are delightful. And where are you on book two of the Astronaut Academy?
Hey, this just came out, man.
I know, but I also know as a librarian that by the time this comes out, you know, you're probably underway on the number two. So.
Yeah, thank God for that. I think that's the hardest part about doing series for kids is that, the minute the first book comes out, they already want the second one. But luckily, First Second did sign me up for two books, so I'm in the middle of drawing it right now. The idea was to be done drawing it by the end of this year, so I'm trying as hard as possible to make that happen.
Awesome. I'm curious, Dave. Hakata has, that mystery around him of, why is he in the academy kind of feeling down and out? You know, why did his parents send him away? Are you going to tell more about that in book two?
I do, yeah. That was something I was debating, was whether that was something that I should drag out. But I've pretty much decided to put it all on the table with book two. And I think that's something that I also took from Avatar The Last Airbender, of not trying to stretch things out, just, you know, being confident in your story and not... So the second book really does resolve pretty much as many plot threads as I was originally spinning up in the air. Well, so that way, if I do a third one, it'll have to be like, you know, a complete reboot.
Speaking of shipping, there's a lot of shipping in Astronaut Academy. Like every other story, I mean, Doug Hero is sitting outside of the teacher's office. I love you. You know, everybody's in love with somebody in your universe.
It's true. Yeah, it's funny. Like I was on a panel at Comic-Con and people were asking, like, you know, why is your book different than most, you know, books in your category or whatever? And I realized, and I didn't say this on the panel, I thought about it afterwards, that it's like, I guess Astronaut Academy is sort of like, it's a boy book about feelings.
Absolutely. I mean, you can accumulate up to 8 hearts in a lifetime. I mean, that's really interesting. And I, you know, the backstory of, you know, the heart that he gave to his best buddy that ended up in Cybert. You know, it's kind of like, wow.
Yeah.
You know, so you really did a good job of, you've got me hanging, going, I want to know more about Hakata Soy, the hero, you know?
Oh, that's great. That's great. Yeah, because I also felt like the first book in some ways is a little bit of a mislead. Like, we introduce Hakata, and then it's sort of like, camera goes off Hakata for most of the book, and then he kind of comes back at the end. But I think the second book really... In some ways, that's really Hakata's book. The first one was kind of just about everybody else, and this one, the second one, will go way more into his backstory and his life and why he is the way he is.
Yeah, neat.
You went out and bought this book, Sharon.
I bought it from Dave.
Oh, that's right. You did.
At Kids Read Comics.
Okay, cool. And as a matter of fact, we can both report that there are students taking the Comic Book Academy right now who, when I mentioned that, oh, tomorrow I'm going to be doing Comics Are Great and Dave Roman's going to be on, mm-hmm. there was at least a couple of boys in the room who went,
yeah.
at the sound
yeah.
of Dave's voice, yeah, or was, Dave's name, rather.
There was a quick drawdown on oxygen in the room.
Yeah. Like, so, yeah, there's a...
Because he's married to Raina Telgemeier.
Then he said, is he the husband of Eisner-winning Raina Telgemeier? I said, yes, he is.
It doesn't hurt.
No. This is a boy who both read Smile and enjoyed it, mm-hmm. but then when I asked him if he read Astronaut Academy, too, he said, mm-hmm. oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you're yeah. making an impact on the lives of young people. So there are boys out there who like stories about feelings.
Yay.
Yay.
So this is the recommendation today, Astronaut Academy and Jack's Epoch and the Cooking Forbidden.
Yeah, I just found these, and I just got started with the first one with Borrowed Magic.
Hey, are you going to do it in your book reads voice or book talk voice?
Oh.
That's what I've heard
about
it.
You know, it's weird because I'm driving in, and I happen to be listening to Alice in Wonderland because I hadn't listened to it since I was a kid, and Jim Dale's the narrator and stuff. Yeah. Well, anyway... The back of the book refers to the reality that Jax is not unlike Alice slipping into Wonderland, except that when Alice comes back from Wonderland, she comes back to the real world, but Jax opens the portal from the fantastical world that she has stepped into unwittingly, and suddenly all heck breaks loose. And it's fascinating. It really is. She grabs onto some armor and a book of, I guess, sorcery, and she is beginning to fiddle with it. From the cover, you can see that sometimes she miscues a little bit when she decides to create a little fire. She burns her hand off and then tries to regenerate it, and... doesn't quite happen the way that she wanted to. So I highly recommend it. That's in our teen collection. And I'm just sorry, Dave, that I didn't have it at Mallet's Creek for me to walk by and discover right away. But, you know, you get us interested as readers, and we go looking for your other works. So
we should also say that this is illustrated by John Green of johngreenart.com. Is that right?
Yes, I believe so.
Mm-hmm.
John Green on, I think John Green Art on Twitter, too, I believe. So.
Yeah, there is an author with the same name, so there's a lot of confusion.
Oh, teen author to boot, so, yeah.
So, see, this is why I think librarians are the front lines of the comics industry right now. Because look how much trouble Dave and I have talking about our own work, right? We always go like, oh, it's kind of like this, kind of like that. I don't like talking about myself like this. It's kind of uncomfortable to say why my book is so awesome. And then a librarian comes in and very lucidly explains what is worth reading in this book. You guys are trained to do this. And so you guys are our best friends right now. I hope this relationship continues.
But
it can't be understated how important you guys are to comics right now, because what you just did right there, that's a real skill.
Well, you're always trying to find, I'm always trying to find a wide variety of books because kids, like adults, have a wide interest in reading, and you just want to be able to offer to them, you know, all the different possibilities out there. And, you know, I love the graphic novels. I make sure to, you know, set a chunk in book talking now for graphic novels. Or comic books, or whatever you want to call them.
Yeah, we can't even agree on what the heck to call the darn things. But
my favorite thing when I meet a librarian at a convention and they'll like buy a book is that they're not just thinking, oh, this book looks really exciting to me. They're like, I know 5 kids in my library. Yeah. This is gonna be perfect for this kid, that kid. Like, I love that they're thinking specifically of who, you know, is gonna get the most out of these books when they're shopping for books. I think that is so awesome.
Librarians have a lot of hearts. So, okay, well, all right, those are in the collection today. Jack's have a Quick and Forbidden. Astronaut Academy will be in the collection soon.
Yep.
But Smile is in the collection right now.
Yes.
Did you see, Dave, that there was a couple girls in my comics class who I asked the students the week before, I was like, bring one of your favorite graphic novels. We're going to discuss them. And the whole idea of the exercise is to get them to think about like how to glean what they like about other authors' work to incorporate into their own work. And so I didn't give them any insight into what they should bring. It's just one of your favorite comics. Doesn't matter what it is. And I think it was 3 girls who brought Smile.
Yes.
Without any solicitation. That was pretty cool.
But
it's getting better all the time. And more girls in our classes, too.
Yeah.
And more girls in the comics section who just read everything ravenously in the comics section. Mm-hmm. It's an amazing time for us. We just got to capitalize on it properly. So, events
coming up.
AADL does a lot of comics programming, more than anybody else in Michigan, I would venture to say.
I think so.
Yeah, you guys are the leaders in comics programming in Michigan. So what do we got coming up next? Saturday, July 30th.
Well, let's not forget today. It's Comics Fundamentals, Session 4. We've had a really dynamic group of adults, very serious in developing their skills. And so that is coming up tonight, 6 to 8 at Pittsfield Branch. And then Saturday we have Chad Sell, cartoonist, who is going to tackle realistic figure drawing for comics artists. It's called Get Real. It'll be at Mallet's Creek Branch from 2 to 4:30, and he's going to get into the muscular and skeletal systems and
anatomical stuff.
Yeah, and he, by example, does some great
look up figures. Chad Sell on DeviantArt. He posts the most amazing, amazing illustrations. Super talented guy. This guy's going to be a star, and he is one of the treasures of Ann Arbor, the Ann Arbor area, in terms of art, and also I'm so glad that he's leading this class. Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Saturday, July 30th, 2011, 2 p.m. to 4:30 p.m. at the Mallet's Creek Branch.
Mm-hmm.
And then also the same day, if you feel like going out afterwards for some fun, you can go to Detroit, the Fillmore Detroit, 7 p.m., the Ignite Great Lakes collection of talks from some of the best Ignite talks in the Midwest area. And I'm going to be doing my 5-minute talk. Comics are great at that event. That's at igniteshow.com/Great Lakes. If you can't make it to the show, no problem. You can watch it happen live. It's going to be streamed at 8:15 p.m. And you just want to go to the igniteshow.com site for information on that. You can watch me fall on my face live on internet television. So
and get ready to listen fast, because Jersey talks like an auctioneer does this.
I only got 5 minutes to explain why I love comics.
Right.
I mean, can you explain why you love your husband in 5 minutes?
No.
See, exactly. You know, even as lucid as your speaking is, as erudite as you are, you know, that's too much of a constriction to put on. And so, yeah, you have to. When I was a kid, I used to practice talking like, I don't know if you remember the Micro Machine Man from on TV. He was the Guinness Book of World Records speed talker. I used to practice talking like that guy, and I'm glad that I did. It's paying off now. Okay, well, thank you, Sharon, for coming onto the show and with the great book recommendations. Thank you, Dave Roman, for being here. YayTime.com, YayTime on Twitter. Are you on the Google Plus yet?
congrats to Raina on the Eisner, and we'll be looking for you in the future too, Dave.
Oh, the pressure. No, you know what? I'm so proud of Raina because I think that a lot of people just sort of throw that around. Oh, you know, yeah, you'll get one, you'll go. But I think it's really hard. I think the fact that Raina's book, which is such a personal story, beat out, you know, all these other books. And I think that, you know, at the end of the day, you know.
Oh, don't trip on me now, Dave. This happened last time. He just blipped out at the end that his internet was out for like hours.
Oh, no.
So, yeah, I couldn't get him back. I had to finish the show by myself. Yeah, there he goes.
There he goes.
Oh, Dave, we miss you already. Let me try to call him again just so we could get that final thought because he was saying something so nice about his wife.
Oh. I think because it is a personal story is why something like that is going to succeed.
Oh, I think that certainly helps. But I think that Raina also has a storytelling style that just speaks to mm-hmm. young people, mm-hmm. you know?
Absolutely.
There's Dave.
Sorry about that.
No, not your fault. It's your cable provider. We'll get that straightened out. I'm going to start a fund to lean on the cable company to get you guys some better internet. You were saying that getting an Eisner is hard, and it was a personal story for Raina.
Yeah, just the fact that, you know, for a book to be successful, you know, it has to appeal to a real wide range of people. And, you know, usually when you think of comic books, you're thinking of fantasy, you're thinking of superheroes, you're thinking of adventure. And the fact that Smile is really just about, you know, a girl going through middle school, the ups and downs, and it really is just her personal story. For everybody to get behind that and for everybody, you know, for that to be exciting enough for everybody to vote for. Yeah. Because a lot of times people just vote for the thing they've heard of. So even if that is the case with Smile, like the fact that many people have heard of Smile is really exciting. And, you know, I can't stress like how proud I am of her for being able to, you know, do something that, you know, mattered to her and then somehow got everybody else excited about it.
It should be underlined. It was a long road too, because I remember Smile as a webcomic years ago when Raina was working on it intermittently, and that was on Webcomics Nation, wasn't it? Oh no, it was on Girl-O-Matic, I think.
It started off on Girl-O-Matic with Lee Hernandez and Joey Manley, their site, and then eventually she moved it over to Webcomics Nation, which is, you know, run by the same people. Mm-hmm. And then, yeah, so she was working on that. She started that around the same time she started the Babysitter's Club project for Scholastic. So, you know, that was, and she was doing it just because she wanted to do something creative and tell her story. She never thought that it was going to be a book. She never thought that it was going to win an Eisner. She never thought that it would be anything, but just a chance for her to tell her own story in comic form.
Yeah. Wow. Well, congratulations to her, and you know, the best luck with the book as usual. And I'll have you on again. I always like talking to you, Dave. You're always a fun guy to talk to.
Well, and I'm home on Wednesdays, so.
Ah, see, so then you can be on every week, right?
Yeah, I'm available. Right. Yeah, as long as my Skype holds up.
Awesome. All right, I win. So okay, everybody should go to yaytime.com today or follow him on the Twitter, and I'll lean on him to get him on the Plus too. So once again, thanks everybody for listening. We'll be online next Wednesday at 12:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time at comicsgreat.tv. Thanks once again to the Ann Arbor District mm-hmm. Library for hosting this show. And until next time, I've been Jersey Droz, jdroz.com, Jersey on the Twitters. Okay, bye.